another edition of Mile High Sports on Denver 8 TV. I'm Marcello Romano, joined as I always am by Danny Williams. Danny, spring is in the air, and that means two things in the sports world. Number one, Major League Baseball season's starting up. And number two, the NFL draft is right around the corner.
We caught up with Jason Hirsch, former Rockies pitcher at his pitching academy. He attempted to try to teach us to pitch. I learned a new pitch. And we talked all things Rockies, failures, expectations. It was a great interview.
All of it, plus eliminating the stigma of being able to pitch at altitude. But towards the end of the show, we'll also look at what the Denver Broncos are doing to bolster up their roster and make a legitimate run at a Super Bowl championship again, a repeat.
Why don't we just tell the listeners who they're going to draft here in the draft at the end of the month?
We'll do all of that and more coming up next on Mile High Sports on Denver 8 TV.
You know, overly successful at altitude.
Yeah, I'm not a big believer in you can't pitch a Coors Field. I think that's a broken record, if you will.
We're back in at Mile High Sports on Denver 8 TV, and Danny, it's April.
You mentioned April, Chilo. April, the 1 month where Rockies fans actually feel like their team's in it. The 1 month where the Rockies are actually competitive for at least a month. We'll see if they can have some staying power this season.
We had a chance to catch up with former Rockies starter Jason Hirsch about the expectations this year and what to expect from the Rockies this season. Let's see what he had to say. So when we come here, we want to get, you know, the word from somebody who's lived the life. You were not only a member of the Rockies, but you had your stay in Major League Baseball. So we want to get your opinion on what we can expect from this year's Rockies team. Obviously, with it being the spring, it's everybody has an opportunity right now.
This is the year, guys.
How realistic is it for this year's Rockies squad?
I think we know that the offense is going to be there. I think it's there every single year, and it always boils down to pitching. And I think that's been the MO for the Rockies for the last 20 years, is can they pitch at Coors Field? Can they hit on the road? That's kind of been the two dynamics. You have a group of guys this year that are going to be tough to compete with. I mean, they're guys that may not have the greatest skill sets, but they're going to go out and compete. But because they don't lack maybe that necessary, that star power skill set, are they going to be able to sustain that throughout the season? I think that's the biggest question mark.
Jason, then the Astros, Kansas City, franchises that were so down recently mm-hmm. have found a way back up. Right. I mean, to the ultimate heights. The Rockies may not have that ace or star power, but what has to happen in order for them to be able to compete again?
Yeah, I think you look at those two examples you gave with Kansas City and Houston. I think you can even group the Mets into that equation. Sure. And say, well, what was the success factor? Well, you had a bunch of young, talented arms that all kind of matured at the same time, right? In Houston, you had Dallas Keuchel, right? In Kansas City, you got some young arms over there, and then they brought in some young arms at the All-Star break to help them make that run last year. And then you look at what they've done in New York with Syndergaard and Harvey and that group of athletes. The Rockies, I think, are looking to do the same exact thing. And I think you can point to the recent transactions that they've made with Troy Tulowitzki going to Toronto, but they get those three arms in return, right? Every move that they make right now seems to be for a young power arm, and they're trying to follow that model and say, well, if we can get enough young power arms in the system and they all kind of mature together, maybe we can have a window to compete in.
Well, seems kind of like a broken record, though, almost. It's like that's the same mantra yeah. year in and year out. So I want to ask you, from your experience when you were signed by the Rockies, rolling into spring training, what's the mindset for you guys, knowing that the history hasn't been there for a pitching staff to be, you know, overly successful at altitude?
Yeah, I'm not a big believer in you can't pitch at Coors Field. I think that's a broken record, if you will.
Stigma.
It is a stigma, and I think it's ingrained in us from the time we're little kids. And we need to find a way to break that stigma. And I think the Rockies over the last decade or so have brought in nothing but ground ball guys. Guys who keep the ball on the ground, that they don't want to elevate pitches. They don't want to, you know, get it into the thin air of Coors Field. And it hasn't really worked out. They need guys that can have strikeout stuff. You need guys that are able to, with a runner on second base, get a punch out and then a fly out and then get out of it. You know, De La Rosa has been that guy the last couple of years, and he's had tremendous success at Coors Field. They need to find more De La Rosas, whether it's right-handed or left-handed. So that for me is the direction I think the Rockies should be going, is looking at those power arms that have that wipeout stuff, because the whole stigma of you can't pitch at Coors Field, I think, is bunk.
Well, when people talk about the culture of a franchise or of a team, if they're drafting very high every year, if they're they have a herd of talented young guys, if they have guys who are winning batting titles every year, every other year, then is it a developmental problem? I mean, what's
I think everything starts at the bottom level, the lower levels. That's where your messaging begins. You know, when you bring in a new pitching coach, like you brought Steve Foster in last year, or you brought in Darren Holmes last year, right? Their message has to go down to those lower levels. Their philosophies, their core beliefs and principles have to start at those lower levels. And some of those kids that are in the higher levels, whether it's AA or AAA, have been under a different set of rules or guidelines over the last couple of years. So it does take time for that messaging to get down there. But I think what's great about Foster and Holmes is that they come in and they've had no excuses. They're trying to find ways to crack the code at Coors Field. I remember talking to Steve Foster last year, and he said, somebody told me it was career suicide to go to Colorado and become the pitching coach there. But his mentality was, well, whoever opens Pandora's box, whoever cracks that code there is going to be a genius. He goes, why not me? Why not? And they've done their research. They're going back and looking at all the years where they've had bad pitching, the years where they've had good pitching and decent pitching, and kind of figuring out what's the common denominator. And it started last year, and it's going to start trickling into this year, but I think they've just lacked the talent in the arms to really put that messaging into place.
Well, they're going to have to put up something like Treadstone or something for these guys. It's going to be like Jason Bourne, because for a lot of the people, like you said, it's an outside perception. So like when you came in, was it automatically ingrained? I got to be a little bit more precise. I got to be on point. I can't miss here or there, because it's not only the thin air, but it's the size of the ballpark. Right. It's so many different factors where they're almost going to have to erase the memories and just pound it into these guys from a young age till we start to see the success come from.
Let me ask you guys both this. The commitment to winning that people may criticize the team for maybe not having all the time.
Right.
Is that fair or is that unfair?
I think to a certain extent it's fair, especially when you look in at what the rest of the division has done over the last couple of years and the moves that they've made. And everyone knows the shortcomings of the Rockies, right? They need pitching. They need pitching. But year in, year out, they balk at signing that big name free agent. And whether that was being scorned from years past with the Hampton deal or with the Nagel deal, whatever it might be, you can't let those indiscretions in the past dictate your future dealings, right? If there's a guy that you want to bring in, go get him, go pursue him. But, I think year in, year out, the fans look at the base or the team and they say, where's the pitching? This has been the greatest free agent market that we've seen in the last 10 years for starting pitching, and the Rockies made zero moves.
Yeah, it's like they got burned that one time. Asked the girl out, she shot him down, and now they're not going to do it ever again.
Never
the
is.
Hampton thing is one of those things that, it was a great pitcher of our generation. He played a lot of different places, but had success everywhere. And in fact, his first 12 starts here, I think it was like 11-1. He was an all-star.
Right.
And then when he left, he was the most boisterous about it. That it's just, that's where careers go to die as a pitcher. So
to your point.
So we can blame him.
Yeah. So to your point, it's going to have to be erase the memory or get them young enough to where, but it's like you said, even young kids in this state, they know it already.
From the time, I get 9-year-olds that come here all the time, like, oh, you can't pitch a Coors Field. I'm like, no, you're full of it.
Yeah.
Right? You have no idea. The same principles of work fast, change speeds, and keep the ball down apply here just like they do anywhere else. We see Cy Young and Hall of Fame all-star pitchers come in here and have no problems, none whatsoever. So what's the difference between them coming in and our pitchers, right? It's just a difference in philosophy. I know they're raising the fences this year. I don't know too many home runs that I gave up at Coors Field where I was like, oh, darn, if that fence was 2 feet higher, that would have been a double. Right, yeah. Instead of a home run. So I just don't see it.
Both of you guys just said it. This last offseason, look what the Diamondbacks did. They added two all-star pitchers, starting pitchers. The previous offseason, San Diego, bottom feeder, Kemp and Shields, big splashes. Then look what the Dodgers do, the Dodgers do, every single offseason. And the Rockies are left, scraps.
Right.
Well,
it's not just scraps. I think they're just afraid to overpay for a starting pitcher, because that's what's going to have to happen in order for them to attract a big name talent, right? If they went after David Price, David Price got $200 million from the Red Sox. The Rockies would have had to give him $250 million to come into Coors Field and say, spend 10 years of your career here.
You got to get a nut. Right. You got to get someone maybe a little strange in the head that just goes about it a different way. Look at the dude in Chicago. Arrieta, who won the Cy Young last year. You got to get somebody kind of a little bit crazy like that. That's not going to buy into all the chatter, because for a lot of these guys that they bring in, the Guthries, Pomerantz, all these guys, they seem to leave and then have the success that we were promised here.
Right. Yeah, I think you have to stick with, when you're the Rockies, you have to stick with a model, right? You can't say, well, we're going to go spend a boatload of money and just try and bring in a bunch of free agents when you're an organization that historically has had homegrown talent. I think you need to have a mixture of the two. You have to be willing to go get a veteran or go get a promising young arm to bring in and be a complement to the rest of it, right? Like I said earlier, we know that this offense is going to be dynamic, and they are year in, year out. It always revolves around the guy who's starting on the hill.
Yep.
You know, and the bullpens, I think, are an easy fix. That's an easy one to get. You can go get a couple of power arms and fix a bullpen, you know, overnight. But starting pitching is not. That's something that when there's a good guy out there to go get, a promising young arm or a guy who's just coming into his own, you got to be willing to take a chance on him.
I think there's it takes money to make money aspect here, where the Rockies do very well.
Right.
You know, every franchise does very well. But if you're spending the money and you're a winner, plus party deck,
right?
Then we're talking
right.
about
now you're bringing
you know,
fans. Now you're bringing fans into the seats instead of just going
and
up
people,
to the rooftop
you know,
to drink for the drink for the night.
People wanting your gear. You know, people wanting to represent.
Yeah, I don't see a whole lot of Rockies jerseys walking around many airports.
Well, look
or
at
other
Danny.
Cities.
He has Navy baseball
right.
pants, a Broncos jersey, and a Broncos hat.
Yeah, I don't know where he got the Navy pants. I've never seen those.
They don't make them.
They
They're
don't.
Softball
not
pants.
They're custom.
Custom.
I think those are for women too.
No. Nope. Right.
Anyways,
great interview from Jason Hirsch. He's an interesting guy who has some great stuff to say. Maybe some more of the same for the Rockies, though, this season.
Yeah, he mentioned how it's going to take a complete overhaul, probably mentally from the ground up, to eliminate the perception and stigma of not being able to pitch at altitude. And maybe it started with you, Danny Williams. Jason Hirsch takes Danny Williams to the mound. That's coming up next on Mile High Sports on Denver 8 TV.
What's my count?
What's your count? It's 1-1. You missed the first one, hit the second. There you go. Good.
Mile High Sports on Denver 8 TV, and Danny, we're talking about the Rockies and their struggles over the past decade or so when it comes to pitching. So we thought we might be able to help out. We have an outside-the-box type of approach. We thought that we could help out, but more specifically, that you could help them out.
Chill, I've always looked at myself as an undiscovered talent. I think I can help the Rockies with Jason Hirsch's help.
All right, so let's do this. Let's get into some instructions,
okay.
Son, right? So we're going to throw from the stretch. So in my world, I work primarily from the stretch with my kids.
Yeah.
A majority of the time as a starting pitcher, even as a relief pitcher, you're going to be in the stretch, right? Unless you're throwing a no-hitter, a perfect game, or it's the first batter of the inning, most of the time you're going to be in the stretch. So why don't we get comfortable being uncomfortable, right?
Yeah.
So go ahead, and you're going to face me. Put your right foot in front of the rubber, so we want to make sure we're not on top. So you're going to face me. So I'm going to be your mirror.
Yeah.
Good. So let's put your right foot in front of the rubber, not on top of it. Nope. This would be in front.
Oh, okay.
That would
Sorry.
Be. Yeah, we're moving forward.
Good. Sorry, sir.
All right. So you're going to get your feet shoulder width apart.
Yeah.
Good. Hands together. You can come set wherever you like, your chest, your belly, or your belt. It's up to
whatever's
you. Whatever.
Comfortable.
Exactly.
Okay.
Whatever's comfortable, right? That's what we want to try and
yeah.
do here. Okay. So our first movement for me is going to be your balance point. And that's just picking your leg up and being able to hold it. Good. See, some athleticism in there, right?
Yeah.
So that's our first movement. After that, you do what you do as naturally. Athletically as possible, right?
Should I?
So, yeah. So let's just do this. Let's pick up to your balance point, and then go ahead and pick up your target down there, and then go ahead and push and fire. Let's just see what it looks like.
What kind? Just leave it
rock
up
and
what's
fire,
natural.
Danny. Rock and fire.
Yeah, you're going to hold up in your balance point and then go. There you go. Right? Strike one.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, we talk about our stride length. So you can see where you stood on the first couple you threw.
Yeah.
Right? We've got a little ways to go, right? We're trying to be athletic here. Let's see how well you stretched out your groin before you showed up today.
Okay.
All right? So you're going to get to your balance point,
right?
And we're going to work on striding all the way towards home plate.
Stride. Is that the key word here?
Stride.
Okay.
Yes. Don't jump. Don't lunge. Don't fall. Stride. Okay. So balance first.
What's my count here?
What's your count? It's 1-1.
Okay.
You missed the first one. Hit the second one. There you go. Good. So you can see you got about a toe short.
Ooh.
Okay, but it's still pretty good. You're on target. That's good. You should throw a two-seamer. So we're
going
to go. So you're right here. You're going across the horseshoe, right? That's a four-seamer.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to go with the seams here, and that's going to be our two-seamer. This ball should move a little bit.
Okay.
You ready? So balance point first. So pick up your left leg. Good. And go. All right. Well, you know what I want to do? I want to see how hard you're throwing it.
Okay.
Because I know velocity is everything these days, right?
Yeah.
Rockies need power arms, and if you're going to be a prospect in this game, you got to be at least 90, 91.
Well, okay. I'm thinking this is like Elitch's, you know, where you guess your own, and
right.
I'm like, oh, 74, and it ends up being like 58.
Yeah, but they use the weighted balls there.
Oh, yeah.
That helps develop arm strength.
Right.
Okay.
All right, so let's go back to our four-seam fastball.
Yeah.
Okay, so again, we're going to hit our balance point and make sure we stride out all the way.
Okay.
Ready?
Yeah.
Balance and go. Attaboy. So now would be a good time to maybe throw a changeup.
Okay.
All right, you know how to throw a changeup?
Not at all.
Of course not. All right. So I'm going to show you a circle change grip. So the one I threw as a Rocky, right?
Okay,
I teach this to almost every single one of my youth athletes. So you're going to go like that. Good. So we're going to take our horseshoe. We're going to go across our horseshoe. Good. Just like that. So we want to make sure that the ball's not touching the heel of our hand. We want to keep it in our fingertips.
That's okay. It feels like I wouldn't have a lot of velocity.
That's good, right? So we want to trust that our grip is going to take the velocity off the ball. So
do you want to keep these kind of connected here? These
yes. Two? So you can touch them, you can curl it, right? Or you can cross it, whatever's comfortable with you. I always just touched it. I didn't feel like crossing it over. Okay, so I want you to hold it like you'd hold an egg. Okay. Don't squeeze it like a lemon. There's no juice in there. It's not going to come out.
Okay.
All right, so nice and loose.
And you don't want it touching your palm, the bottom of your palm.
No, so the more we get it in our fingertips,
If
we take that and push it down there, that
gets
it all the way, right?
Okay.
So nice and loose in your fingers, but I want you to throw it like a fastball, right? Don't think about like throwing a changeup, right? If you slow your arm speed down or slow your motion down,
the
hitter knows, right? So let me see, just like that 61 mile an hour fastball that you threw right down the middle on.
Okay.
Make it look the same.
Now, yeah, you might be in danger over here.
Heads up, boys.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, let's see it.
Okay.
All right, so we took a couple miles an hour off.
I felt like I didn't throw it as hard as I was throwing.
No, like I said, there's a lot of friction in our hand when we put that many fingers on it, so that's what's going to take the velocity off. So I want you to hold it even lighter. So I'll tell a lot of my students, like, this is when I held the ball, go ahead and pull it out of my hand. That's how hard I would hold it when I threw it. All right, so I want the same light finger, light touch when you throw this one.
Oh, wow.
Make sure you're in front of the rubber.
Oops.
There you go.
I want to stay on top of it. Okay.
I can't wait to see him slipping. There you go. Good. Well, there's our velocity drop, right?
Yeah.
So that's very typical. A lot of kids, when they throw that first time, they'll either spike it in the dirt, they'll throw it off to the wall, or they'll throw a perfect strike.
Okay.
Right? So that's we're well within the normal ranges right now.
Okay.
Okay, here we go. Let's try it one more time. Hit your balance and then go. Attaboy, very nice. Perfect. So you've got a 5 mile an hour drop, right? When you're in the upper 50s, low 60s, a 5 mile an hour drop is like a 10 mile an hour drop when you throw 90.
All right, Jason, as we let you go, we do want to get a prediction from you. Obviously, we're hopeful right now about what the Rockies could be. It would be a magical run if they kind of were competitive late in the year, but how do you see it playing out? And give me a guy that you're looking forward to watch this year.
I'll start with that one because I think there's a lot of promise in John Gray. I think he's pitched really well this spring training so far. I'm curious to see what his mental makeup is once he gets back to Coors Field. He had a little bit of a tantrum last year at the end, talking about how I can't pitch at Coors Field, but I think he showed a lot of promise on the road. I think that's a guy that most Rockies fans are going to want to watch. My prediction for the year is all going to be based on starting pitching. If the pitching can stay healthy and be just midline, it doesn't have to be good, it doesn't have to be bad, just midline, I think they'll be fairly competitive. If the pitching drops like it has in years past, you know, the Rockies are going to be looking at a top five pick in next year's draft. I understand that it's maybe not what Rockies fans want to hear, but you look at the moves that have been made in the division, you're pretty much going to face a Cy Young candidate or two in every team that you're going to face in the National League West. So it's going to be an uphill climb for them for sure.
Well, we certainly appreciate your time, buddy. We appreciate it and teaching him a little something here. Well, that was fun. I want to thank Jason Hirsch for having us out at his baseball academy, teaching you a few things, showing you the ropes, how to be a pitcher. He was great. Now, I don't think I can say the same thing about your velocity, though, Danny.
I'm working on some technique and some fundamental issues, but they're going to send me to the Eastern Carolina League.
To the Eastern Carolina League. Maybe the Fantasy League? A fantasy camp. You can pay for a fantasy camp. Maybe the hot stove heats up. They give you a call December, January next year.
That's cold.
No, that's cold. What are you doing?
Waiting for the Rockies to call.
Okay, well, while you do that, we'll change gears. Coming
Rockies?
Up after the break, after on
Mile
High Sports on Denver 8 TV, You can find out what we think the Broncos should do as they head into the draft. That's all coming up right after this.
Draft gurus have him being right there at that 31 position, but there's a couple teams in mind that they might have to hurdle over to get to Paxton Lynch.
Back in Mile High Sports on Denver 8 TV, and Danny, with our baseball discussion over, now let's get into what the Broncos look to achieve in this year's NFL draft. What are the needs? Obviously, I think a lot of questions need to be answered in the coming weeks leading up to the draft. I'm not sure that we have a quarterback in position, so do those questions need to be answered first before you can attack the draft full-fledged?
The quarterback position is going to shake itself out a little bit, and I think the Broncos could draft a quarterback as high as the first round. One guy we like is Paxton Lynch from Memphis. Big, strong. Upside to him is he's been compared to Jake Plummer. I'd say the upside, the extreme for him is size-wise, like a Big Ben. Maybe more athletic, but that's the extreme. If the guy's a star.
Well, he's like a clone of Brock Osweiler. If you just look at the measurables, 6'7", 225, can throw, although a lot more athletic than Brock Osweiler. So if they loved what they had in Brock as far as measurables went, and you see that the guy's mind is ready for the NFL, maybe you take the flyer and you do it in the first round. I just don't know that John Elway, I don't see him doing that unless it's a slam dunk kind of pick.
Paxton Lynch is kind of a hot commodity of late a little bit. The Broncos may have to move up a little bit to get him, but if they love him, it'd be well worth it to do it. But go ahead, sorry.
No, you're fine. I'm gonna have you put on your GM hat. You're John Elway now, and the draft is next week. Give me the guy that you think, say they stay put right at 31. They don't make any moves. They don't go forward. They stay right where they're at. They're going to just make the selection there. Who's the guy there that you pick at 31?
My draft philosophy is always in the first couple picks, the first round, the second round, you take the most talented guy. They still need some offensive linemen, some
talent,
offensive line
need.
Help. They may need to find a replacement for Malik Jackson somewhere. You know, pass rushers are a hot commodity as well right now. Everyone wants a pass rusher because of what the Broncos defense did in the Super Bowl. But I'm going to think outside the box a little bit. And I'm going to maybe look a little long-term with a couple guys who I like. One is a receiver from Pitt. His name is Tyler Boyd. He's 6'1". He's in the mold of like a Keenan Allen. He's going to be right there for the Broncos to take. Emmanuel Sanders has one more year left on his contract at the end of this year. He's going to get paid a lot of money, maybe by another team. That means Demaryius Thomas needs another kind of a running mate, and I think this guy Tyler Boyd from Pitt could be a perfect fit.
I get the logic behind it. When you look at it, you wouldn't automatically say Broncos need wide receiver, but I do get the logic. And if your philosophy is the draft best player, not for need, but just best talent overall, you could see that happening. I, on the other hand, I'm going to take a just seeing what John Elway's done in his short time as general manager for the Broncos is he's been able to take advantage of guys that have fallen late for whatever reason. Roby fell to them because of an incident, where he was cited for DUI.
Shane Ray, Derek Wolfe.
Shane Ray last year, the same thing. Derek Wolfe was a surprise pick, so inside I'm feeling it's going to be like a Derek Wolfe type of pick, something that none of us are expecting. We don't know. We don't even know where this guy came from. Maybe it'd be one of those things where you're like, wow, it's a little bit higher on their board than most teams had him. But a guy that I like and would follow in the mold of what he's done lately, a guy who's fallen because of off-the-field issues, is Robert Kimdichie, the guy out of Ole Miss. As they start to lose pieces on that defensive line, why not bring in a guy who's ultra-ly talented, has a couple character issues, but what better guys to take him down the road than a guy who's turned his life around in Von Miller and Mr. Big Brother himself in DeMarcus Ware.
Let me give you one more guy to keep your eye out for. A guy who is a thumper. He's a bigger TJ Ward. His name is Carl Joseph. He's from West Virginia. He's a good player. You wouldn't think they need safety help necessarily. They did lose David Bruton, though. Adding this guy, who probably the eventual TJ Ward replacement. Absolute thumper, physical, passionate guy. His MO is being a real football guy. I'd take a look at him as well.
I would say next what we'll discuss is if they move up. That's your guy if they move up. Is that a move that it would have to make a move to
just
jump
a little,
up a little bit?
Right there, probably mid-20s.
I think if they move up, it's got to be someone that they love. If they do fall in love with Paxton Lynch, I think he'll still be there. In fact, a lot of draft gurus have him being right there at that 31 position. But there's a couple teams in mind that they might have to hurdle over to get to Paxton Lynch. I think the first one is the Rams at 15. They say they're going with Case Keenum. They like their quarterback situation. I don't believe it for a second. They might surprise some people and take him there. If it's not there, the Jets at 20, they're not happy with Geno Smith, although they drafted Bryce Petty last year, or you know, in the draft as kind of a project to build forward. I don't see it happen at there either. The last hurdle would be an interdivisional hurdle, and it's the Kansas City Chiefs. I think they're kind of looking for Alex Smith's replacement, and Paxton Lynch could be that guy. If so, if the Broncos have fear of that, they may have to jump up five spots to get him, and they'll be able to get him at that point.
Chello, it's going to be interesting to see what they do with that pick. They're going to get a good player. John Elway and the Broncos are in good hands when they're on the clock.
Well, speaking of on the clock, we're on the clock as well. We got to wrap up this edition of Mile High Sports on Denver 8 TV, so we want to give our thank yous, Jason Hirsch and his pitching academy. Danny,
David.
Thank you.
I want to thank Chello. You're great.
I want to thank the Ice.
Casey.
The Ice Bucket.
The other Casey.
Casey.
Mikey.
Casey. David. Mikey.
Todd in the back.
Hey, Todd. Thank you.
Thanks, boys.